Good afternoon. My name is Ron Collins. I'm also known as Sensei Ron Collins. I am the author of various books on the topic of ninjutsu, jujitsu, street fighting, military tactics, and such for Dojo Press. This is a basic introduction to describe my street-focused jujitsu system. The core concept of this system came about because I looked at traditional martial arts. They had a very good base and a very good concept, but at the same time, they were taught ineffectively for modern situations. People are learning to protect themselves from knives and guns, which, don't get me wrong, is good, but at the same time, we're training with nunchaku size and katanas, weapons that they're not even going to have access to. What I did was streamline my system. I made it more street effective. I took a lot of scientific principles from modern sports medicine and from modern competition martial arts, and I mixed them with a little street know-how. I put together what I felt was an effective fighting system, what I still believe is an effective fighting system. There will be three more parts of this, which will explain some of my concepts, some of the building foundations for it. I believe the first foundation that has to be laid when dealing with martial arts is the mind. Once you get past how the mind works, how the mind affects situations, it allows you to focus more on avoiding, controlling, and potentially manipulating situations to avoid violence and conflict. At the same time, the foundation of my system is based on the philosophical view that the first option and the last recourse of a wise man is violence. Anyone can go with violence. Violence is basic, it's animalistic. But at the same time, it's not something that we want to go to directly. It's better to control a situation without having to use violence. There's kind of a cycle of violence that whenever you create a violent encounter, whenever you're the winner of a violent encounter that someone else creates, they in turn have a tendency to want to return violence on you for being the winner of the situation. And a lot of times it's easier just to manipulate, withdraw, or avoid a conflict. And in some cases, it's even better to lose the conflict outright than it is to allow yourself to have to deal with a return of escalating violence. There's a basic understanding that people don't realize when it comes to street fighting. Self-defense, street defense, whatever you want to call it. That basic understanding is there's two ways to win a conflict. The first way is to be better than the guy you're fighting. To be smarter, to be faster, stronger, more technical, more skilled, whatever. This is all very common. The problem is, when you address that at the same time you're addressing this, you also have to realize there's another way to win that conflict for the people who aren't better than their opponents, and that is by escalating the violence, by being more violent than the person they're fighting, by doing more damage, by creating more shock value. A good example of escalation of violence is this. A lot of sport martial arts trained, especially with mixed martial arts, trained to fight with clinch. Even in karate, jujitsu, ninjutsu, especially Muay Thai, this is popular. The idea of fighting from a clinch is allows you to control the head. The thing about it is that most people don't address is for all that head control and everything else, there's a way of enhancing the violence done, escalating the violence. Instead of simply grabbing the head for head control, grabbing the hair for head control, which is something vastly overrated. Come in with the traditional double ear slap taught within traditional martial arts self-defense. When you do this, and you come in with that double head slap, it disrupts the fluid in the inner ear. Because of that, the person's balance is thrown off. Well, this allows you to come in with the, again, double head slap, hit the ears, disrupt your balance. So if your balance is disrupted, you immediately lean in with a headbutt. This breaks the nose, again, causes more shock value because they haven't quite recovered from the first one. For me, the first blow you slap in the ears. And then as you grab the head, the hair, whatever, and pull them forward into you, which naturally causes their balance to want to tip forward, you take your foot and stomp their knee. Well, this has the unique effect that since their body's coming forward and their knee's being pushed back, it snaps the knee. It's very effective, very simplistic. Well, most people who are training for sports combat, for combat sports, will enter into it and try to outbeat the person, outstrike them, outgrapple them, whatever. They'll go into a clinch and immediately go with knees and elbows, which, while devastating, is still a sport format. Remember that Muay Thai isn't so much a combat art as it is Muay Thai has always been referred to as the sport of kings. It is a sport. It's a very violent sport, but it's still a sport. When you look at that and then the way I just described it and the damage done, the intentional damage done, you're talking about escalating the level of violence. Now, it's not so much a matter that you have to escalate the level of violence. It's just knowing that you can. The basic core techniques that the sports teach are the techniques that get you to the point where you can deliver the more devastating blows and enhance that level of violence. By enhancing that level of violence, you create not only shock value to the person that you just had an altercation with, but you create shock value for those around you. For those who have witnessed this and have seen the shock value and go back and tell their friends, it creates another version of the escalation of violence because, oh my god, he did this. And there's this whole shock value, this whole stigma or stereotype that people will walk into it. Good examples of this in movies would be the recent Never Back Down. The guy fought three guys on the street who had no skill whatsoever, just three guys in a car that decided to talk shit. Well, that went back. That escalated the level of violence because, oh, he did this, the shock value from it. And that's something that people don't realize. When you carry that reputation with you, and you carry that shock value with you, what happens is the guy who's going to fight you, and there will always be people who are going to fight you because they want a name for themselves, or they want that little respect they think that you have that they don't, is they're going to come in and they're going to escalate the level of violence. They're not going to come in and it's not going to be a fair fight. They're going to come in and say, well, gee, this guy's a badass. He's a hard ass. So instead of trying to fight him fairly, I'm going to make a point that I want to increase the level of violence. I want to escalate the level of violence, that I'm that much more dangerous. So they're going to take a baseball bat or a tire into you. In the event that you beat them with them being armed or them having friends to back them up, what happens is, and it's very common, is they either accept that they've been beaten down by someone who is so much superior, which rarely happens, or they get mad, and this comes back into another part where I'll explain the theory of victimization, where they're going to take a sawed off 12 gauge or whatever and blow you in half, or they're going to come at you with a knife and ambush you from behind. And again, this is something that people need to understand. This is a concept of dealing with situations outside of a school, outside of the classical self-defense teachings. If you understand this, then when you go into scenario drills, you understand how to control a situation without having to directly or indirectly put yourself in danger. A lot of times you realize that just by letting someone attack you and you block it, everything they throw at you because you know that you can take them out, you know that you can take them down, that everyone will say, oh, well, he lost the fight because the other guy was throwing in more punches. Now, this is part two. This is where I explain the five animal theory. My concept wasn't based so much on five animals and five animal kung fu. it was based more on the underlining idea of totems, I guess you would say. The idea is more to reflect an attitude than an individual. In this case, my five animals are cats, dogs, wolves, bears, wolverines. Very Western, I know. The basic one, the bottom of the totem pole, is of course the cat. The cat's what you're going to find in 80 to 90% of the people on the street. It's just Joe Average, who wants to sit in a bar, drink his beer, go home to his wife and kids, work his 8 to 12 hour day, and be left alone in relative peace. These people will avoid conflicts, they'll avoid fights, they'll avoid trying to see who's the bigger, badder man on the block. However, if you back them into a corner and you threaten their family, anything of that nature, they're going to come out tooth and nail. So while people might consider the cats to be the big pussies, you also have to remember that even if we're talking about an individual who's a coward, you drive them into a corner, they have one way of getting out of that corner, and that's through you. The most dangerous thing in the world is a coward, because fear will make you do some really crazy shit. And when we're talking about people who are afraid, they have two things as an advantage against you. One, they see you as a threat, which means they're going to end that threat by whatever means necessary. And two, they have fear. And with fear comes adrenaline. The more afraid they are, the more adrenaline they have. And you can talk about fine motor skills versus gross motor skills and all this other stuff. None of that matters. It's as simple as, I'm scared. I have a huge adrenaline rush. I have a threat that has to be neutralized. To that end, they're going to come at you with weapons, with the most practical forms of stacking the deck in their favor. And, like I said, this relates to that five animal theory. Now, the next guy on the totem pole is a dog. And I laugh every time I hear people call each other dog. The dog on my little totem pole is all bark and no bite. They share the same mentality as a dog. Watch National Geographic. It'll explain it to you just as well. These people are all bark and no bite. They sit there and they bark and they make a lot of noise, wanting you to be afraid of them, to be intimidated by them. Now, when you are, you run away from them and they'll chase you down. And when they chase you down, they're going to come at you because you're afraid, and they're going to smell fear, and that's going to be what chases them, or what drives them. If you encounter a dog on the street, depending on the breed of dog, and it'll come to you barking and snarling and snapping and everything else trying to get you to run away. If you run away, it'll chase you down and attack you. If you stand your ground, the dog will hesitate, even for a few seconds. Now, in the practical world of a street fight, hesitation is what will get you killed. So this guy trying to get in your face, the talk shit, to prove how tough he is, who's mouthing off, who's trying to scare you, who's telling you he's a gang member, or he's a badass, or he's already killed someone, or he's been to jail, or whatever the excuse, he's trying to intimidate you and back you down. And yes, he'll act like, oh, he wants to go, he wants to fight. But in most cases, no. He just wants you to think he's going to fight, so you'll submit, and just fall back to the four interactions of human beings in conflict. Now, above him, you have wolves. Wolves are basically dogs who need their friends to support them before they start running off the mouth. Then you have bears, which are essentially just dogs, but instead of having their friends, to get their bark and bite, they use their size to intimidate you. These people are really big. They're either big and fat or big with a lot of muscle, and they really don't want to fight because it's just all a matter of posturing, which we'll discuss later. And they want you to be intimidated by their size. They want you to think, oh, well, he's big, he's going to hurt me, I want to avoid this. Now, if you've noticed, 3 out of the 4 totems on my little 5-animal theory have been people who don't want to fight. Now, this makes up 99.9% of the people you're going to find on the street. And here's the shitty part. Then you have that last type. You have the Wolverines. And Wolverines are people who, for whatever reason, don't really care about themselves a whole lot. So they care even less about you. These are the people who their primary goal is to end the situation in the most expedient way possible. Now, by end the situation in the most expedient way possible, what I'm referring to is that these people will fight. They will fight at the drop of a hat, and they will cheat to get there. These are the people who bring guns, the knife fights, and show up an hour late for a gunfight just so they can shoot you in the back of the head. I mean, these are the people who just do not care. If they're not going to posture, they're going to go straight into a fight. And they're very rare. This is the worst case scenario because you're talking about someone who is antisocial, which covers a whole list of things, but we're talking about psychotic antisocial. Now, these people with being psychotic antisocial are they're a very rare group. But when you come across them, and they're real easy to spot, these are the ones that dogs and the wolves and the bears will stay away from. These are the guys who will basically eat them for breakfast, and they know how to spot these guys, so they generally try to avoid them. Now, most cats don't know the difference, don't know how to spot a wolverine. Some do, some don't. And like I said, these are attitudes. So these attitudes can vary from person to person. I've seen guys who were fundamentally wolverines go down and become cats. You know, they worked a 9-to-5 job, they just want to be left alone to enjoy, you know, to enjoy what little bit they have out of life. The thing about wolverines is most people with wolverine mindset have nothing to lose, so that makes them dangerous. And I've seen wolverines become cats. I've seen cats become dogs and so on. I've never seen a wolverine become a dog, a wolf, or a bear. I've seen the other three little shit talkers become wolverines, and usually this happens after about 20 to 30 years of being in and out of jail, in and out of really bad situations they put themselves in. I've seen people who were wolverines when they were younger get older and become that cat mentality. They just want to be left alone with their family. They just want to go work their job and go home to their wife. And then they avoid conflicts, they avoid problems. Of course, you threaten that home, that family life of theirs. That's when they come out tooth and nail, and usually when these guys do, they don't come out like the regular average tabby cat. This tabby cat suddenly turned into a giant fire-breathing tiger, because these people aren't going to, it's not going to be a matter of, oh, okay, well, I'm going to come at you tooth and nail because I'm scared. It's, everyone has that pressure point. It's, you've hit the pressure point in my life that I won't tolerate. So when they come at you, they come at you with a sawed-off 12-gauge, and they won't stop. You can say, oh, I got friends. Okay, they're going to kill your friends. You can say, well, I have the police. Okay, they don't care. They're going to go to jail. And it's that little pressure point that you have to know how to hit that causes the problems. And then you don't ever hit the pressure point on these wolverines, because when they come at you, they come at you straight on. Okay, this is part 3. For those of you who have seen part 1 and part 2, I've talked about the escalation of violence and my 5-animal archetype theory for what you're going to deal with on the street, the 5 attitudes you're going to find. Right now, I'm going to talk about the 4 instinctive reactions to conflict. It's a sociological theory. I'm not the inventor of it. I can't think off the top of my head who it was. But they basically broke the fight or flight concept down. There's an interspecies conflict resolution that occurs in all species of the same type. When you're confronted with a grizzly bear, you have two choices, fight or flight. When you're confronted with a wild dog, fight or flight. When you're confronted with an annoying neighbor or that violent soccer dad or whatever, a mugger or whatever, you're talking about, you have four reactions instead of the simple two. Fight or flight is still a part of it. It's still a factor that you have to consider. However, you also have submission and posture. And this is, it's a sociological thing. You can see it in other animals and primates and dogs, and cats and birds and fish, whatever. But it only occurs between interaction between, with conflict between the same species. How this essentially relates to it is you have to understand this. This is a core foundation for my system. I'm going to start with posturing. Posturing is where a person tries to make themselves appear more threatening than what they really are. The purpose of posturing is that you avoid conflict by appearing stronger than what you are. Militaries have done this for years. This was a method of the Iga Ninja back in feudal Japan. They made themselves appear stronger than what they were and appeared to have more people than what they did. This backfired, in fact. So instead of being attacked by an enemy force that was 10 times larger than them, they were attacked by... They were attacked and outnumbered 100-1, which was a severe disadvantage. The basic idea of posturing is if you believe I'm more of a threat to you than what you are to me, you'll back down. Posturing has only three reactions. There's only three reactions to posturing. There's submission, retreat, and fighting. Submission is where the person gets up and they say, you know, I'm a thug, I'm a badass, I'm whatever. And for whatever reason, they try to establish themselves as the alpha, the dominant one in the group. It's common, it's not that surprising. And in fact, we're not all that different from Wild Kingdom because usually we do this in reaction to... trying to get the best out of society, the best, even right down to trying to get, you know, more females interested in the male character, or the female trying to chase away other females from the male that she wants. It's sad, but it's true. We're basically a bunch of primates. So, a person, two people posture. The one who makes himself appear to be a larger threat will assert himself, and the one who believes the other person to be a larger threat will submit. Now, this is a unique thing I want to point out, because submission is not the only way. You have... retreat and fight. In most cases, most people will not kill another human being in a fight. In fact, actually, we have certain psychological triggers which make it hard for us to kill another human being. The closer they are to us, the harder it is for us to kill them. It's easy to shoot someone, which is why sniper attacks are very popular, but it's a whole different story of getting it close. It takes an antisocial personality to kill at close range. It takes a very psychotic personality to kill at close range. And if you're not psychotic and you're not antisocial and you kill at close range, it causes a great deal of mental and emotional scar. Then you have retreat. Now, people, especially younger people, are get this mixed up. Retreat is not submission. Retreat is let me get break away, let me regroup, and let me reattack the problem. If you posture and a person retreats, you can call them a coward or whatever. But here's the problem with the issue. If, let's say we're dealing with that wolf pack mentality, three guys picking on this one guy who is maybe a little smaller than the so-called group alpha, but at the same time stands a good chance of being able to take the group alpha. Well, he looks at these three guys trying to attack him, they're threatening him, and he runs away. Well, these three wolves take it as, he ran away, and of course they're going to attempt to chase him down or whatever. Basic canine mentality. But the problem is, when this person retreats from the situation, he's going to go back, he's going to mentally regroup. And then he's going to come back with something that will even the odds. More than likely, he's going to come back in a way that will not only even the odds, but put him in a clear advantage. A clear advantage could be a gun. It can be his friends. It can be his friends with guns. This is something that you have to understand. It's the same thing as military science. When you're confronted by a larger, stronger force and you retreat for two reasons. Either to head off that military force, dig in, and await that larger force to come get you. To do what you can to stack the deck in your favor so that when they're hitting you, they're basically, you know, smashing themselves against the wall. Or you go back, you regroup, you intensify your numbers, and then you re-attack the larger force. And you can combine these two. You can go back, regroup your numbers, and dig in and let them crash themselves against an even larger wall than what they thought. This is that retreating mentality. And then, of course, you have fighting, which is a real, you know, you know what fighting is. But then you got to understand, if you're, this is where that five animal part that I discussed earlier comes into play. If you're coming in and your mentality is to be a wolf pack or to be a dog, and what, you know, this quiet guy sitting by himself is what you think, oh, well, this is the guy that I'm going to mess with. And it turns out that you didn't bite into a cat, you didn't bite into another dog or another wolf pack, you bit into a wolverine, and this guy's going straight for escalation of violence. He's not simply standing here and saying, okay, we're going to fight this and prove who the alpha and who the beta is. He's going to say, okay, this is cool, I'm pulling out my old friend Colt 45, not the 40 by the way, and he's going to blow you away, or you're going to come in to hit him and he's going to pull a knife. And people don't really consider that the mentality as well as the sociological makeup of human interaction. They don't teach this in martial arts, but this is what's going to keep you away from danger and a more simplified concept. Fourth portion of my little street folks jujitsu explanation. And this is what I refer to as the theory of victimization. This relates back to the theory of escalation of violence from part one. When we're discussing the whole theory of victimization, it can be summed up as simple as this. I've been victimized, therefore I seek other people to victimize so that I can avoid, at least in my mind, the fact that I've been victimized. This is why child molesters molested children become child molesters. This is why women who have been raped will go out of their way to blame men for their problems. And a lot of these problems are things that they themselves create. People want to avoid the concept that, you know, victimization occurs in society. You can't avoid it. It's just one of those human interaction things. So when we're talking about the theory of victimization, it's basically, it works like this. A person has been victimized. They have been harmed in some way, emotionally or mentally. Many times this is attributed with physical victimization. What happens is they go out of their way to find another victim. This need not be physical confrontation, such as what I was talking about, child molesters and rapists, who again stem from those who have been molested or whatever as children. This also comes back to people who have grown up in violent households and have been beaten by their parents or what have you. And this is a really touchy subject for a lot of people, but it's something they have to address and accept and deal with. People work it out their own ways. This is my favorite example of this. A lot of people place blame on inanimate objects as an excuse for the whole trying to make someone else a victim. By this, I'm gonna give you an example. These anti-gun people. Well, I was shot, and we should take guns off the street. You know, that's their mentality. Well, here's the problem. Guns can be used, they can be used to stop violence as much as they can be used to cause violence. The best deterrent for violence is the shock value of escalated violence. Like I mentioned in the first part of this. Well, here's the thing about it. You can say, well, there would be less violence if there was guns on the street. If there was less guns on the street. No, there wouldn't. There'd just be less shootings. The tragedy behind this is that the people who have been victimized by guns blame those who... they don't blame those who victimize them, or they do, but they blame the entire gun culture as a whole. So, well, they have to victimize people who own guns by attacking the gun. I've seen this with martial arts, and this is really sad. This is part of the political problems we have when it comes to martial arts. People make martial arts a sport because they want to avoid the combat aspect of martial arts. They want to avoid the image of combat, the image of being able to harm another human being. So they water things down, turn them into sports, which competition is not a bad thing. Competition is good. People get stronger and better and faster through competition. They get more experience through competition. But they often will leave out the escalation point of violence from where the competition allows you to reach to where you can escalate the violence to become more effective in a fight. And they focus on the sport aspect. Well, now, again, they're victimizing the people who are more combat-oriented because they're cutting that portion out to focus on something else. I have friends who are not martial artists who are opposed to violence in any form, shape, or form. And they quote many of these left-wing bullshit philosophies for the reason why they are, because, you know, violence is wrong. Violence is a tool. It is a sociological, idealistic tool. It can be used to help people, to free people, to save people's lives. The best example of this I can think of was an old kung fu movie I watched. This hardcore badass assassin was nearly killed and was taken in by some old Chinese Buddhist monks. And, of course, in all Chinese kung fu movies, they were Shaolin monks. And while he was raised and enlightened and taught in the Shaolin Temple, he had already had various kung fu training, and they taught him, you know, other forms of kung fu, less violent forms of kung fu. Towards about the middle of the movie, more assassins come to kill him, and he ends up defending himself without killing them, and they're all knocked out. I think there's about three or four of them. And the old blind master is standing there. And the guy says, well, master, what do I do if I don't kill these... If I do nothing, these people will come and kill everyone in the temple. But if I go after them and I kill them, then I will be put on a path of bad karma because I will be answering violence with violence, and violence is wrong and everything else. And this old enlightened master simply looks at this former assassin and says, "Ah, but if you kill them, will you not be saving more lives for all the lives that they were taken?" The assassin says, "Well, yes." The old master says, "Well, then, why would you not go out and kill the bad people, the people who are causing the death and the destruction, putting an end to this death and destruction?" The assassin says, "Well, master, isn't violence wrong?" And the master goes, "No. Violence without reason is wrong." And that's where we get into the whole concept of, you know, ideology. You can blame the inanimate object. You can blame the violence. You can use it as a tool to label, to make someone else a victim because you have been victimized. And this is a reoccurring theme in society. We see it all the time. It happens with, and it's something that's been overdrawn in society. You know, we have people who say, "Well, we want equal rights," and then when they get equal rights, because equal rights come with equal responsibility, all of a sudden they don't want the responsibility anymore. So they try to alienate themselves and alienate others because of race or sex or religion or economic situation, whatever. And it's all because they feel like they're a victim and they feel they're entitled for something. Well, that whole sense of, you know, I've been a victim and I'm entitled to something and I don't have what I'm entitled for, it's all a continuous bureaucratic nonsense. You cannot walk into a situation and say, "Oh, well, this, I'm entitled to this because of this. I should have this because, you know," it's this whole theory of victimization is based on the fact that people will take, and we've actually seen this now, where people actually try to make themselves the victim of something so that they can say, "Well, I'm entitled for something else." And psychologically, the idea, like I said, it comes back to, I'm not a victim if I make someone else a victim. And people who, whether a person is legitimately a victim of something or they simply feel that they're a victim of something, their immediate response is to go out and attack someone else and make that other person a victim. Because by making that other person a victim, they feel some sort of personal empowerment or entitlement that they don't get from simply accepting life as it is. When you understand this, you understand where a lot of the conflicts in society come from, where a lot of the attitudes from society come from. This is something that I honestly believe if you address early on in martial arts training, it not only teaches the student exactly where and how to apply techniques, but it teaches them when not to apply techniques, when to avoid and react to a situation differently that would otherwise not have the further escalation of violence that we really don't need. Alright, this is the fifth and final piece to my Street Folks Jiu-Jitsu system. This is the part where I put a lot of what I mentioned before together. Just a brief recap. Part 1 talks about the escalation of violence. The escalation of violence is basically cut and dry, real simple. Two ways to want to fight. You're either better than the other guy, or you're able to become more violent than the other guy. I like the escalation of violence, but I like the escalation of violence better for the simple fact that A, it sets an example, B, it gives you some sort of reputation, and see, it avoids the concept of making you look weak, which the appearance of weakness is why criminals target other people to be victimized. This was covered in the theory of victimization, which was mentioned before. Then, of course, there's the other parts on conflict interaction, namely how we enter into conflicts, the four stages of conflict, posturing, making ourselves look bigger to impress and scare away the other guy, submission, admitting the other guy is tougher than you without actually fighting him, retreat, which actually means they're just going back to regroup, even if it's just mentally regroup,
come back with a baseball bat, sawed-off shotgun, what have you, and just straight out fighting. We also have the five animal theory, which was, unlike the others, which were drawn from psychological material, psychological, sociological material, actually, textbooks and so on. Mentioned the five animal concept, which was purely my invention. The thing about the five animal concept to bear in mind is it's an outline. It's not a hard set rule. Nothing is written in stone. This video will deal with de-escalation theory and avoidance theory. Now, de-escalation theory works good for stress-based violence. Stress-based violence is just person has a hard day at work, someone does something or says something that grates on their nerves or triggers the emotional memory of something that had been done before, and so they become stressful and they become volatile and their emotions bubble up, primarily fear, which turns to aggression. They go into defense mode. In that case, you have a 50-50 shot of controlling stress-based violence. Most stress-based violence is characterized by simple assault. However, there are occasions when people will pick up a foreign object and use it as a weapon, in which case it becomes a aggravated assault. Now, there are essentially four stages to de-escalation. The first one is to acknowledge transgression. It's very simple. You just say, you know, hey, I'm sorry, didn't mean to look at your girl. I'm sorry, that comment was out of line. I'm sorry, I shouldn't have, you know, spilled your beer. The next thing you do is you be apologetic. Not only do you acknowledge the transgression, you apologize for it. Again, you say, you know, hey, I'm sorry, let me get you another beer. I'm sorry, I didn't realize she was with you. I didn't mean to, you know, disrespect you that way. You know, please forgive me. Then you go on to stage three, which is saying, you know, hey, you're redirecting the whole situation. You're sitting there and, you know, well, look, you know, let's be cool. Let me buy you a beer, you know, to show you that I'm sorry, that I don't mean to start something. You know, let me apologize, just let me get out of the way, which goes straight into the fourth stage, which is breaking contact. Now, the whole time you're doing this, the whole purpose of this is to get that person's stress levels and their emotions a little bit lower. And that way, without that adrenaline surge and that reflex to go on predatory defense mode, what happens is they're less apt to be violent, they're less apt to act out with violence. Now, when that fails, you're stuck with fighting. You have one of two ways to deal with it. You can be better than the other guy, or you can just be meaner and heighten the level of violence. You don't necessarily want to go so far as to halfway kill a drunk buddy or some random guy who it was your fault because you were hitting on his girlfriend type scenario, but depending on how much bigger he is than you, and you also have to bear in mind that some criminals will and do use the image, the excuse, the pretext, if you will, of stress-based violence to close the gap, to get close enough to you, to attack you, to mug you, or whatever. Beyond this, it's real simple. You can apply it different times in your life and see how well it works. It works good with road rage. You cut somebody off. They're trying to swerve and run you off the road. You stop, acknowledge your transgression, be apologetic, you know, tell them that you'll pull your car out and let them be able to pull out in the traffic and get ahead of you, you know, and then once they do, you break contact. Even if you got to go around the block to get away from them, do so. There's no telling when something might trigger the emotional surge again. So that's the whole reason for breaking contact. If you're in a bar, leave the bar, go to another one. If you're in a small town and you only have one bar, go to, you know, the furthest corner of the bar. Beyond this, we go into avoidance theory. Now, avoidance theory is a six-parter. The first point to avoidance theory is to know your trouble locations. High crime rates, bad reputations, known for having certain families that are certain, have a certain prone the violence type mentality, stuff like that. You know, basically, it's real simple. There's a difference between Beverly Hills and the ghetto. You don't want to go into, you don't want to be from Beverly Hills in the ghetto, and you know, a person from the ghetto out in Beverly Hills, even though they're going to be seen as out of place, they're not really going to be all that targeted for anything except for harassment by the police. So you want to know where the troubled spots are and where to avoid them. That cuts down most of your risk of crime-related violence. Always look for trouble. Always be on the alert. Don't think just because you're in a nice neighborhood or you're in the suburbs that crime doesn't happen. It does. Another thing is you need to avoid risky behaviors. Now, there's a lot of reasons for why these are important and why some of it has to do with violence directly, some of indirect violence. First of all, try to avoid drinking and drug use outside of your home. Drug use is a bad idea, period, but if you're going to do something of that nature, do it outside your home. Don't do it outside your home. Keep it private in your home. Usually with a small group of people, because you don't want to drink with by yourself, because that's one of the factors, at least alcohol is. Next to that, you don't want to drink or anything of that nature in large groups, especially around people you don't know. Now, here's the issue with large groups. With large groups, well, said best by Nietzsche that, you know, stupidity is an exception in the individual, but it is the rule in large groups. You factor in alcohol or anything that obstructs, obscures, or manipulates perception, and it makes it a harder issue. It makes it a more volatile issue. You don't want to drink with people you don't know. You don't want to be out of your mind or unable to properly defend yourself around people you do not know. If you don't know them, as a rule, you do not trust them. That simple. Avoid illegal activity. Again, coming back to drug use. Buying stolen objects off known drug addicts. Even things that you normally wouldn't be considered direct criminal activity. Criminal activity is focused around a subculture, which is usually both poor and very violent. Not all criminals are violent, but many are. Also, engaging in criminal activity also usually leads to a higher rate of property crime. So if you don't get things stolen, don't have people prone to stealing around you. You also don't want to associate with known criminals. That kind of goes back to the illegal activity thing. There's another issue regarding having casual sex. I know the hooking up trend is real big, and people are always getting on the internet looking up people to go sleep with and everything else. It's just one big orgy smorgasbord out there. The problem is, as sex becomes so casual, so does the spread of STDs. More importantly than that, it's not uncommon for women in social environments who have very low morals to pick up men for casual affairs and steal things while leaving the man's house, or they go back and they have their friends break into said person's house and steal their stuff. And it goes the same way for men as it does for women. And what will happen is, on the night that this occurs and they do steal, they're going to be spending most of their time with you so that you can't blame them while their friends are going through your stuff and breaking into your home. So it's something you want to consider. You don't really want to be alone with strangers. And by being alone with strangers, I'm talking about, like, say you're at a frat party. This is a common scenario. Girl's at a frat party. She's with the guy she just met. She thinks he's cute and nice and sincere and honest and all this other crap. You put a few shots of tequila in them, a couple beers. Hey, come look at this thingy, this project that I'm doing on my computer. Hey, we're alone. Let me put the moves on you. She says no. He's drunk. He doesn't care. Date rape occurs. Or forced rape occurs. It's something you want to avoid. It also, now, for guys, you know, because I know guys are thinking, oh, I can't be raped. Well, just remember, one in every four women have been sexually assaulted at one point in time in their life, and one in seven men. some statistics, whether or not they're accurate, it still doesn't look good. There's also another, and they might be outdated. Also, there's another factor with being alone with a person makes it easier for them to place criminal charges against you, which happens a lot. For guys and girls who come from families with money, especially guys, it's not that far-fetched, like the lacrosse team, for example, a few years ago, who got accused of rape simply because they had money. There's an issue of avoiding people who like to fight and are prone to fighting, whether they're just the bullies, the tough guys, whatever. There you go into, you evolve in this violent subculture, usually linked with drugs, alcohol, gang-related activity. This is pretty common sense. Drinking in a public place. That goes for both bars as well as, the local park. It's just a bad, it just leaves too many variables for bad things to happen. The fourth thing that you need to realize is that when you do drink, and you're outside of your home, use a buddy system. In fact, for a lot of things you do, that, especially if they take place in high-risk areas, or high-crime areas, use a buddy system. At least two people together at all times. Not leaving a drink in the bar that left unattended, your friend stays with it or whatever. Make sure nobody slips you a Mickey. Or a roofie or whatever you want to call it. If something doesn't feel right, it's not. If something feels wrong, leave. Make an excuse if you have to. Try to bring your buddy along if you can. If they utterly refuse to go and you keep making excuses and everything else, it's just a simple way to do it. Leave your buddy behind. Make a note of when you last saw him, who you last saw him with, why you left because it didn't, what made you not feel right, and leave. If something happens to them, you have that information for the police the next day. Also, limit the information you give the strangers and friends that you know are drug users. I don't want to use the word addicts, we'll just say drug users. Most users tend to be addicts. It's illegal, especially if it's the harder stuff. And the more they're inclined to do things to feed that addiction, the more likely they are to betray your confidence. Now, I'm going to get into basic footwork, stance, break falls, stuff like that. If you'll notice behind me, I'm doing this outdoors. It's cold. There's snow in some places. This is wet concrete out here. And I'm doing this specifically on wet concrete to prove a very specific point. That being that you're going to have to adapt your training to the environment that it's used in. What that means is that most fights usually will end when a person hits the ground, especially if they're hitting concrete. A simple single double leg takedown that you learn in a high school wrestling class can potentially kill somebody depending on how they land. Because of this, you have to be able to protect yourself on how you land when you hit the ground. That's less important in training with mats and stuff like that, but since we're training for self-defense and fighting techniques, guess what? Basic concept behind break falls is that you fall or roll partially with the momentum, and you bring your arm out at a 45-degree angle, like we demonstrated later, to slap the ground and absorb the shock. This transfers the shock along your shoulder blades, the flat of your arms, and keeps it away from causing a whiplash effect on your head. Not sure it stops you from fighting. No, I'm sorry, actually stops you from fighting. Not that, that was good for the shot. Alright, I'll be dealing a lot with break falls. At this point, break falls are important because they're what keeps you alive when you hit the concrete. It's very important to stay focused in that regard, because the basic principles behind it,
your arms come out at an approximate 45 degree angle. You slap the ground with the whole flat of your arm and use this to absorb shock from the impact along the back, shoulders, and arms. With your head tucked, this keeps you from A, having a whiplash type effect, B, impacting your head on the ground. There are essentially three major break falls. Those are the forward fall, the back fall, and the side fall. Now, if you'll notice, it's cold, so I'm going to try and make this quick. There'll be a little bit of explaining later on throughout this. Basic back fall. It actually stung my hands a little bit because the ground's not level and because I just slapped the wet concrete. But the basic idea behind it, if you notice, my chin was tucked, so it kept me from doing that. My arms came out to stop me. It created a counter impact of energy to kind of cancel out the energy that was from me falling back. That's the basic one that everybody starts off learning, and that's really important. Because the front fall is just a variation of it. Side fall is kind of a variation of front fall. So it breaks into different things. Next I'm going to get onto the forward break fall. It's a roll initially. You start by rolling forward. Then when you come out again, you do the counter thing. When you start out, it's always a good idea to use your hands to control your momentum. However, when you get to more advanced levels, you won't even need your hands. You just roll forward and you can tuck yourself into a ball and come out. Again, I'm going to be demonstrating this on wet concrete, so as much as you might not realize, a training under demoralizing conditions such as on wet concrete, any kind of hard surface that offers no give in cold weather, as a primary example, in a fight, in a real fight, you're going to be hurt, you're going to be hitting, you're going to be getting hit, you're going to be contorted at different angles. And so basically what's going to happen is you're going to be demoralized. Every time you take a punch to the face, it's going to demoralize you. The conditions you're in are going to demoralize you. And this is just one way of training to deal with demoralizing conditions. Since you're somewhat used to them, they don't seem quite as painful as demoralizing. You're like, yeah, it sucks, but I've been there before. It's part of psychological condition. Alright, now if you notice, when I came, I kind of rolled from the shoulder and came out with one hand. There's an importance to this. You can do this one of two ways. Because the ground's unstable, well, slight slant here, it's hard to see with the video, I actually used one hand kind of in a half forward, half side break fall. It's just one of those things that came out. The reason why is because this arm would have reached the ground first, and this one here would have had a big hole thing to go with. Plus, when I fell, I led with this shoulder. And it's real important that you understand you have to lead with a specific shoulder. You don't want to roll on the flat of your skull because you'll hyperextend your neck and actually injure yourself or potentially break your own neck. Like I said, that's one of the hazards you're dealing with it, when you're training on concrete and in conditions like these, which you have to do to get used to fighting conditions like these. What happens is you'll end up, well, in a real fight, you can end up getting yourself killed. A simple judo shoulder throw can cause you to land on your face. Keto techniques that is considered gentle and non-aggressive can smash you face down the ground. And this is where self-defense and street fighting is much more different than traditional martial arts is taught in a dojo, because, or even sport martial arts, because your environment is your enemy. The ground coming up at you as you're falling towards it is your enemy, and it's something you have to train for and condition yourself for. And formal martial arts normally don't do it, but you also gotta think, there's a lot of guys who are training in formal martial arts, military hand-to-hand combatives, and stuff like that. There's martial arts that have been designed in prisons that are taught to biker gangs and street gangs that are training in these conditions. So, pretty much, it keeps going back to the idea of you train for the environment you want to fight in.
Front break fall. Now, front break falls vary in that you're absorbing the shock on your chest and stomach. This is where stomach muscles come in really handy with. It's not so much of how even a beer gut comes in handy for this, because it's just more a tissue absorbing shock. In my case, I got a little bit of a beer gut, but I also have abs, so it doesn't really matter. Do 5 sit-ups in a row. It's important because when you fall, you're going to land with your forearms first and slap with your hands to kind of create the counter force to absorb the shock when your body hits.
Now,
I'm going to demonstrate from the side position. And it's really easy. Basically, instead of tucking your chin, because to do that would bust your forehead or face wide open on the concrete, on the asphalt here. I'm going to look up. In fact, I'm going to kind of lean my head back as far as possible while the front of me is dropping. Now I'm going to bring my hands up like this, so I'm going to be like in an almost praying position. Then, beyond that, it's basic self-defense-wise. When you hit the ground in this position, you're going to immediately want to roll to the side, so it's not to give your opponent your back. Shoved out or to be caught from surprise and having the back of your head kicked, smacked when you're facing against the ground. It's cold, wet, so it really sucks. I'm going to get into footwork for this next part. Footwork is very simple. There's basically two types, linear and circular. Of course, you'd have to be an idiot to only think that you can only use one of the two types. They get mixed up quite frequently. Basic idea is that linear is simply an angle of approach. You can, or retreat, you can move forward to back, side to side, or at an angle to that, which is, you know, back to the side or forward to the side. Circular, you're actually moving around the opponent instead of simply keeping them at a singular point. In a fight, a lot of times people move around, things move up, so it's not that big of an issue. Then I'm going to get more into the two major basic types of stances, open and close guard. Said basic footwork, I notice when I'm using pants. If I want to go lower, I just put my knees out. If I want to move forward, I just put my forehead and push off the back leg. Give me a sudden burst of explosive power. If I want to move back, I just bend this knee to retreat. I can do all this from a stable footing position. And like I said, linear circular movement. Linear movement is simple. If I want to move forward, one, the other. Back, one, the other. If I want to move to the side, take an angle of the approach of my opponent, it's one and the other. Well, that's more of a circle stance, kind of. But it's still sideways approach. Now, the ground below me is very slick and hard. So, footing is key. In this type of terrain, yeah, most fights will go to the ground. In this case, my feet are a little bit closer together, so they don't necessarily have to be way out here in a wide, deep stance, so I can move forward and back, but can stay relatively close together. Like I see with Aikido or Wing Chun.
And of course, if I'm here and I'm being attacked, I can just... a lot involved in the footwork part. At the beginning stages, I recommend students focus primarily on shifting their body weight, learning to not push off the rear leg, but bend the front knee to generate the forward dropping power, use gravity. I recommend that they practice the break falls and footwork, basic stance part of it, back and forth. There's not much of a difference in hand positions. There is two basic major hand positions in your stance work. These are the core ones that I teach. It's basically open and closed guard. Real simple, and open guard is almost like a boxer's crouch, like this, from the side, it looks something like this. Your chin is tucked into your shoulder, prevents uppercuts. Your lead hand is there to block with. It's real simple. You're here, you can block. Even if you want to, you can use the low blocks, which you can't demonstrate because the camera's hanging at the moment. That'll be covered in more detail later. This hand stays back here so you can protect your chin and your throat. You can, of course, raise this hand to protect your face from the side, so it's not like you're just in a linear spot and this big open gap here. All it is, it's just that. Then the open guard is more of a traditional stance. Your lead hand is out further. This puts your closest natural weapon to your closest natural target, which is your lead hand to their face, eyes, throat, like that. Also, it's important to remember that the open guard is less defensive. It's more of an offensive posture. You're not going to stand there and say, okay, come attack me. You're more or less going to do this if you want to play that. If you're wanting to attack, you're going to be in a normal, in a regular normal stance. And then when you strike, usually with the lead hand, because it's the closest natural weapon to the closest natural target, you're going to step forward and hit here and keep this hand out so that you can grab while this hand comes in to hit with, or you can come in and go for the eyes here and then knife hand strike and then follow up. When you get into more advanced levels, you work on speed hitting drills. So you're going to hit somebody 3, 4, 5 times with that lead hand, distract them, and then come in with the reverse hand, which is going to have all the power behind it. One of the really important things about this to remember is that when you get into your stances, there's a lot of finer points in this video. This is the day after I did the stuff on the break falls and everything else. This is where I'm going to get into a little bit of hand techniques. Using your hands is actually more important than your feet. There's a few kicks involved in the system, but it's not going to be a lot of stuff like you can see from Taekwondo. Basic idea, and something to keep in mind, like I've said before. We're talking about delivery systems. Fist is a hand weapon, a knife hand strike is a hand weapon, a finger jab is a hand weapon. We're not talking about specific techniques involving these, but we're talking about the delivery system to apply them. We'll get into the differences involving hand strikes later. Fundamentally, for now, I'm going to get into a few of the basics, and I'm going to demonstrate with the basic techniques, and then from there you're going to see where the original material on shifting body weight and footwork comes into play. We'll work with simple transitioning from jab, or transitioning from just standing into an actual fighting posture, into a jab, into a simple jab, reverse punch combination, and
and I'm going to show you where the open and closed dart are applied. We'll also take careful notes of the strikes. As I'm doing my strikes, the knee motion, the knee movement, all that pretty much puts going into effect. Later on, I plan to have video demonstrating this to another person. For right now, I'm just going to work with the same basic stuff that you're watching this video, which is themselves and their own imagination. Alright, now, begin with, if you were in an altercation, attacked, such situation, not being blindsided from behind, but actual face-to-face confrontation, your opponent, attacker, however you want to put it, will be here. They will do something, whether it's an action which makes you fear for yourself, makes you think of reaching for a weapon, makes you think of drawing back to hit you. That's about the time you're going to strike. From that point, you're basically here. They do something. You step forward, unless you hit. Even if you want, come forward. Doesn't matter. For sake of argument, simplicity, you're saying, straight jab. Instead of falling back, stepping forward into your initial close guard hand posture, this. You're simply going to step forward, jab, come back. That's basically getting into the initial altercating strike. Now, we're going to take that to the next step. And bear in mind, this is all principle, it's not hard setting. But it's going to be really simple. It's going to be a matter of some tell, some sign that they plan to physically harm the presence itself. And you open with a strike. Now, instead of retracting your hand all the way back to the initial closed guard posture to defend yourself, since you've already taken the bicep arch, you open with a strike. You're simply going to strike and come back into a half guard. Suddenly reel from two successful strikes, which you think would be far faster than you actually are. Going to move forward, listen to this, pull up my rear foot for the first punch. Notice that my knees will bend as I do this, and I'm not just turning and punching, it's different. If done properly, you can usually step forward with the rear foot to pick up the first punch, which again, it's a far greater amount of the body's mass behind your punches. Whenever people tell you that martial arts size doesn't matter, that's a lie. Physics is simple. Mass times acceleration equals power. The fist does not have enough mass, no matter how fast you accelerate, to do the damage. Body behind it. It's extra weight, extra mass, extra density. Now, we get to the next strike, which is going to be essentially an uppercut. Same thing applies, which it's even better. It's an even better opening strike because it's more of a sucker punch. You hear they present themselves as a threat. You step forward, uppercut. Notice again, the whole principle of shifting my body, when my body is coming forward and down as his hand raises. Now, as I'm doing so, normally I'm set right here for firing strike. However, instead of simply tracking back from slow position, you can go briefly from that to the open guard. Looks to be here, opportunity presents itself. Uppercut. Immediately after the uppercut, right arm slightly down to a jab. Or do what's called a back thrust, but this hand works out. This one is also a variation of this one, which is seldom seen in a real fight if you're in a traditional karate, but it still works either way. I think you got surprised with it, especially boxers who keep their hands like this because you expect them to have axe. And again, in both cases, the stand here, step forward, uppercut, back fist. It's still with the power from the reverse punch. Now, I want to demonstrate this kind of pull. This is going to be a linear attack with Jiu. Here, the person presents the opportunity to threat danger. And immediately, uppercut, back fist, reverse punch. If you do it rapidly in succession, the Jiu will not have time to recover. Again, same principle, except this time with the jab, jab, first punch. Jab, jab, first punch. Again, I slowed down, I hesitated. It became much faster, especially since I'm closing it. Since I'm only withdrawing my hand partially, I'm still allowing for a greater amount of speed. I still have to rock my body back and forth using my knees.
Now, for the next part, I'm basically going to work with kicks. Kicks are really simple. There are basically two types, long-range kicks and close-range kicks, what's referred to as infighting kicking. Infighting kicks are more or less variations of sweeps. They're used to damage the legs. They're seldomly used in clinch fighting by sport fighters because of the damage they can do, especially while you're holding a person's head in a clinch. I'm just going to go over the basic four fundamental kicks as taught in street-focused jiu-jitsu.
Basically, like I said, you're going to work with four major kicks. The first one is simple. I don't recommend kicking above your waist. Any time you go above your waist, you're losing power and balance. So all your kicks should be low, primarily at knee, thigh level, groin level, at max no higher than your waist. So if you're a taller person, you're going to have your knees and ankles anyway. So basically what we're looking at is your modification, done your jab, jab, reverse, they've taken a step back, they're recovered, whatever. And however you go, you're put in a position to where you have only two options. For a front kick, you have to kick off your weak leg or your rear foot. neither takes. It's generally taught that if you're kicking off your lead foot, it would make you think that your balance is going to shift back with the rear leg so you can do so, which is good for a defensive kick. If you want to go offensive, it falls into your basic footwork. Instead of this, instead of out, what you're going to do is you're going to step forward, kick. Now, there's also a thing called a stomp kick, which is essentially a stomp heel. It's commonly used against the down opponent. It's also outlawed in UFC. Most of the competitions. So, you don't really get to see it effective. Used there much. It's oftentimes a finish or strike. The days of steel toe and steel heel boots, especially when it's the letters, this is dangerous in the process. Now, coming from the rear foot, where you're going to develop most of your power, all it is like pushing off your rear leg slightly, bending your rear knee, and it switches if you're just going to take another step. Except, as you do, you're trying to move this leg. Snap back. So what you're going to deal with is going to be essentially a sidekick, your foot is literally going to snap out to the side. It does not have to be a complete 90 degree angle to the side. It can be as simple as slightly in front of you, slightly behind you. Just like a front kick can be somewhere out to here. Your sidekick will be somewhere out to here. Now, in the case of sidekicks, sidekicks offer for distance, especially if somebody comes in close to your sidekick, a lot of power is one of those powerful kicks taught in your joints. So, what will initially happen is you're only fighting stance, you come in jab, jab, guy falls back, another guy's coming at you from the side. From the side angle, he's coming at you. You have a great deal of things you can do. You can switch positions into a fight, or keeping your eye on the guy who's down, and as he's coming closer, you can simply chamber, kick, and recover. Now, it's a little hard for me to do this because, again, I'm on ice. Now, to your point, plus I'm in gym, which restricts motion. It's important to train in the conditions when you're fighting. If we walked around 24/7 in the gi, everything would be loose and good and move it back. Since we don't have that advantage in every case, well, that's what you got. In your case, here, guys come in, chamber, kick, cover, back kick. Your head out of range. The biggest enemy you have for a sidekick is a person who either catches your leg or sweeps your foot, takes out your injury leg. In most situations, most street fights, you're not using a lot of kicks. And when you do, they're going to be at any level. You may have knees, ankles, stomping on people's toes. Not going to be doing Jackie Chan, jumping, flying spine, flying kicks, you're not going to be bouncing up walls and back kicks. It's going to be straight, simple, and direct. Back kick is no exception. Then you're going to take it out to 3 times. Goes on the ground with a broken nose, you're going to figure out really who you got that with power from the jabs. The other guy just got some side kick. Doing that, your immediate effect is not going to be what you
guy. He comes at you from behind.
And then with a back kick,
you have two ways to do it.
Either standing on your leg, up, and snap back. Or what you do is you're here. And as he's coming at you from behind, sneak forward again and snap back. Now, what I'm doing doesn't look picture perfect, but that's because, again, I'm on snow and ice.
These are conditions you might have to find yourself being caught in when you actually have to defend yourself. This is a huge advantage to a grappler, to a ground fighter. It's a very bad advantage to a person who kicks. Which is why I'm training worse than I'm fine. On top of that, if I fall and hit this concrete, it's a grappling and the asphalt here.
Recover, basically knees, elbows, throws, takedowns, sweeps. I want to take a moment before I get into this to cover various hand weapons. I've already covered general means of delivery in the first few sections of this. Various hand weapons will have a different approach to your infighting, different methods that will be used. These are pretty much considered advanced techniques in many martial arts. It's also considered a more specialized style of striking. Targets are generally start off with I'm going to talk about the basic punch. I explained basic methods of doing so. I never got into the striking surface, which is this knuckle and this knuckle, the two knuckles here of the fist. Right before you strike, it's always going to snap your arm. That way it lines the bones of the wrist and the forearm with these two knuckles. It allows you to put all that body weight and energy into it as you're striking. There's variations of open hand strikes. For example, a finger jab, which is just these fingers here. One method of doing so is to overlap the fingers, or to overlap the middle finger over the trigger finger and your ring finger. This has a little bit of stability to it. Now, when you're doing your finger jabs, it's important to realize your two major targets will always be the eyes and the throat. Now, when you're striking the eyes, always aim for here along the cheekbone and use the natural curvature of the eye to guide your fingers back into the sockets. As the eyes hit the sockets, and your fingers are driven into the sockets, is when you want to hook them and pull down to break the eyes. Just putting this on the edge of the eye socket here, as I'm pushing it back against the lower lid of my eye and then hooking, and I'm actually hooking it into the eye socket. I'm still pulling down the lower eyelid. So if I'm actually have my fingers gouged deeply into your eyes and I hook it and pull, I run the possibility of ripping this lower eyelid. That will cause blood, it will cause pain, it will also cause panic and shock. Another important issue is striking the throat. Now, again, as I mentioned, using this for the eyes, you can use two fingers, you can just keep your hands loose, which is what I generally do, a loose jab. As you're aiming for the throat, you go back to the conventional overlapping fingers. And I'm gonna demonstrate something that you can try yourself to prove my point. Sometimes a knife will work or a broadsword won't, as the saying goes. A bullet can do more than a bomb. That's another way of putting it. The idea is that certain techniques, certain hand weapons, cannot access certain portions of the body because of the natural structure of the body. For this reason, I'm I'm getting into the finger gouge. Aiming against the throat, a lot of people say, well, I tuck my chin, so you can't hit my throat. Well, it requires a lot of accuracy to be able to try and hit the throat, especially with somebody's chin tucked down. The trick behind this, however, is that if you aim here and right up the natural angle of the chest into the throat, even tucking your chin will offer no defense. It'll stop a fist, but it will not stop the fingers. For this experiment, all you need to do is tuck your chin as so, make your finger jab as so, strike here, and just push it up into your throat. Natural curvature of the hand, actually, your hand will actually force the chin away from the chest as it goes further back in. So what that does is it gives you a significant advantage, whereas somebody thinking the chin is tucked, they can't be hitting the throat, and then pow, they are. Another important thing to remember is that when you're in your basic closed guard, I'm going to demonstrate momentarily, with the chin up and so, this whole area of the neck is exposed, and the trachea, the windpipe here, is still able to be hit here. It still has this whole big area exposed to it. Now going into that, going from that, I'm going to go into another variation of strikes, and it will be a basic thumb strike. Many times it is combined with a palm heel strike, and all that you really pretty much are doing is taking the thumb in your hand as so and gouging forward. It's simply as such, gouging forward, where these hands would move beside the face and the thumb would go into the eye. It can be used to strike at the corner of the mouth, grab and fish hook back. It's a very nasty technique to come forward with two, such as come out, double fish hook the face, and as you're pulling away, headbutt a person, you run the likelihood of not only pulling the mouth back this way, which tears the tissue here and here, but if your headbutt happens to break the nose, you're pretty much permanently disfiguring a person within a matter of seconds, going directly into a clinch. Another issue is palm strikes. I want to clarify on something before I get into palm strikes. There's a difference between a palm heel strike and an open hand slap. Open hand slap has basically two functions. Otherwise, beyond that, to me, it is useless. The first function is that you use it to utterly insult the masculinity of an opponent, to just come in and slap them like a female. Or, I mean, just it's an insult. It is the actual definition behind the meaning of the word. In the Bible, about slap turning the other cheek, it's not a statement saying to be a pacifist, is a statement saying that if someone insults you, do not return insult for insult. It's also a tradition of common Western dueling culture, because the idea was at the time that the only time a man used an open hand was to correct a disrespectful child, to spank a child, or to shock a hysterical woman back into the present. So when a man walked up and slapped another man, it was the greatest of insults. It was calling him like a child or a woman. Which is why whenever it was common in TV and everything else for people to think that with a duel it was common for someone to slap the other person, it wasn't. It was just a way of pissing them off so they would accept the duel. But beyond the whole disrespectful portion of the technique, it's also used to strike the ears. Now, I want to point something out. You can see with the shading and the low light, there's a natural cup to my hand. A lot of people tell you to cup your hand or cup your fingers as such when you slap the ear. Do not do that. For one, you have gaps in between your fingers and it allows air to escape, which is not going to damage or rupture the eardrum. For two, you have this natural little suction cup type area here, and your ear in itself is its own natural suction cup. so that when you're striking it, both of them will kind of expand out, push the air out, and then seal, which will keep some of the air trapped in and push it further into the ear, which is where rupturing the eardrum comes in. Also, when slapping the eardrum, you disrupt the inner ear fluid, which is responsible for your balance. And as such, you can disrupt the person's balance by shocking them in the ear, aside from rupturing the eardrum, which in and of itself will cause a great deal of issues with balance and coordination. Beyond that, the regular palm heel strike is a weapon type technique. Uses this portion right here of the hand. It's generally the muscle in the hand is tensed. I use what is referred to as the tiger claw strike, which is a variation of both a finger jab and a palm heel strike. It's not so much a little meow, but a roar of a strike, sink in, claw, and rip. If you ever watch the Discovery Channel, you'll see lions and tigers attacking their prey, and when they do, their paws slap together, and it's actually a strike, and then the claws sink in. It's not so much grab and hold as it is strike, grab, and hold. That's basically the action you want to mimic. Now, how this works is you have essentially two different types. You have a side palm heel strike, which, like I said, allows you to put the thumb into it. So you can actually do multiple strikes all at the same time simply by striking a person in the face using the palm heel to hit them along here, the nose, and using your thumb to go for the eye. If you're really nasty about it, you can usually hit the nose, break the nose, and get the thumb in one of the eyes, so that not only do they have the broken nose, which is going to cause the eyes to widen, they have the sudden shock and pain of having a thumb gouged into their eye. In mind, we're talking infighting. Infighting is going to be dirty. That's where the finger jabs and the eye gouges and the biting and the clawing come in. Now, you also have the rising palm heel strike, and it's like I said, a variation of an uppercut. As you come up, the hand hits, the palm strikes, and as soon as it does, the fingers come forward and gouge into the target. So if you're hitting the chin, your palm will strike here, the fingers will come forward here. Even if they're tucked in, they'll hit here and be driven up. And as they're driven up, you're straightening them out. So it's strike, gouge, hook. Strike, gouge, hook, pull. And as much as you're busting the mouth, the chin, nose, whatever, you're also hooking the fingers into the eye sockets to pull down and tear this tissue. Now, a lot of people don't realize this, I mentioned this in earlier videos, but when you're fighting on asphalt and concrete, taking a spill to the ground in any way, shape, or form is going to hurt you. So when you're suddenly blinded and bleeding and in pain and can't see me and I get behind you, or I execute any number of takedowns and throws and slam you onto that concrete, the damage I'm doing is geared towards, the throw is going to do an enormous amount of damage because of the nature of the environment. And the damage I'm doing to you is not always coming from me striking you or twisting your joints to cause pain, but simply by using the environment against you. The same can be true as if I'm standing with a brick wall behind me, and you palm heel strike my head into the wall, have your fingers in my eye sockets, and then repeatedly start slamming my head into the wall. Or take me to the ground, start slamming my face into the concrete. Then you have a variation of the palm heel strike, which I mentioned earlier, which is the downward strike grab pull. The last thing I want to get into, which is a little bit safer than the finger gouges, is extended knuckle strikes. Now, extended knuckle strikes come out of a variety of ways. I mentioned one using this knuckle. You can also do so
using this knuckle or this knuckle or these two knuckles or these three knuckles or these four knuckles, all it's commonly referred to as a panther fist. I'm not too sure about the two and three or four knuckles in that form. But it's situation might arise where I'm not required. I'm not really sure I'd teach it anyway. That's less likely to come up, but it's still good information. Now, we're getting into the extended knuckle strikes. I need to explain the physics behind them. They're pretty much the laser beam of punching. Now, assuming that my two knuckles here and here take up, let's say, 2 inches of space, and my punch has, let's say, 10 pounds of power behind it, these two knuckles each will take a portion of the power behind my punch. So my 10 pounds of power will suddenly become 5 psi between these two knuckles. If I'm striking you using only this knuckle or this knuckle, which is this preferred method, by the way, and this knuckle takes up, let's say, half of an inch, I'm actually putting 10 pounds of I'm actually putting 10 psi into half a square inch, therefore creating the effect as if I have, or the liquid shock, the liquid body shock of having 20 psi directed into the body. It allows what liquid force is used to concentrate. Now, if you're accounting for me using my full body weight, full power, everything else coming into this little strike, and let's assume we're talking, let's say, 20 pounds of pressure instead of 10. And I'm putting it into this, we're talking about 40 pounds of pressure being directed to a single location. If that single location happens to be an eye, a major blood vessel such as your carotid artery, the kidneys, the throat, any number of other places, we're talking about consistent deep tissue damage. We're talking about the possibility of internal organ and blood vessel damage. Even the possibility of going through soft tissue to attack bone beneath. After this, I'm going to get into knees, elbows, sweeps, takedowns, things of that nature. And of course, the hook punch, which I said, is used for a variation of a grappling technique, which will also be demonstrated at the end fighting phase of training.
Going into knees and elbow strikes, the body mechanics and everything else pretty much lines up as the same principle used with the long distance striking with my fist or my hand weapon. So I'm just going to pretty much outline a few basic concepts and let it go from there. Then we'll get into the knee strikes. There's going to be two variations thereof. I'm going to go for the hook punch, which I'm going to do right now. Now, a hooked punch is essentially a roundabout way of striking. It's very similar. I can do it from either hand. I'm going to demonstrate it towards the camera so you can understand what I'm saying. Now, when I do this, when I come from the lead hand, all it is my hand will be here, and it will drop when I shoot it, instead of shooting in a straight line, which will allow me snap your weapon close to natural target, following along that principle. What's going to happen is I'm going to go out and up, out and down. The idea is to go outside the guard to come in and strike, and as I am, you'll notice the arm goes first, and then I'm torquing my weight. This leg is bending the knee to drive me forward as my hips are turning and my body's pulling the punch in. And of course, from here, back fist, elbow, punch magic. The reverse punch, it's very much a similar thing. Instead of going with the linear reverse, I'm going with closest weapon, closest natural target principle. I'm coming out and again bending the knee, torquing, and coming in. Now, how this relates is you're going to demonstrate, which I'm going to demonstrate later on, towards a grappling technique. Instead of closing in, the person who's a strike at me, grabbing, whatever, step in, allow their arm move past my head, and then come in with the hook. As the hook hits them, it creates the opening shock from pain and from impact. It's an initial shock that surprise. Wow, I just got hit. It's outside their peripheral vision. They're going to have that tunnel vision when the adrenaline hits. So it's going to take them by surprise, and as it does, it's going to allow my arm to simply come over and trap theirs momentarily while the other hand moves in a strike. From here is a few variations of different techniques I can do. Stand up, put a person on the ground, or simply break their arm where they stand. But like I said, those will be explained later. Now, going from that into the knees and elbow strikes, basically, same thing. We'll start off with the rising elbow strike. Remember, keep the blade of your forearm, the bone of your forearm, on the inside of the strike. So that as I'm coming in, instead of uppercutting, remember, same principle, as far as balance and weight and everything else goes. As I'm coming in for that strike, instead of a linear strike like that, coming in with an uppercut like that, all that's going to happen is I'm at my elbow, and I'm simply going to come in and up. It's just the same as this, except a little bit more shorter, using the inside of the forearm and the elbow. Now, there's a reversal technique of that, which is a downward elbow strike, and it's commonly used against people duck or try to tackle you. It's not going to be a defense for keeping you off the ground, it's just a way of hurting them on the way down. That being a downward elbow strike. You can also use this as a way to block and patch the ribs. Your fighting stance may use the ribs and you bring your elbow down or come down with the elbow. Block. Your principle is basically just like I showed. Fighting, arms up. They're coming down, throwing the leg, whatever, you're catching the ankle, it doesn't matter. And then you simply drop the elbow. Simple, straightforward, direct. Beyond this, you can use the rising elbow strike and downward elbow strike combination. It's pretty common with Muay Thai and some other martial arts. That as you're fighting, that as you step in with the rising elbow, for them to jump up and come back down. I'm not going to jump up because it's kind of not that safe on the ice, and plus I have to get out of the angle of the camera. Now, you have two more types, which is a inside elbow and an outside elbow. Again, blade of the forearm stays to the inside of the strike. Basically, it's going to put a punch instead of using the fist and coming out, or to step in an elbow. And the beauty of the inside elbow is it's a perfect setup for an outside elbow, which again, if you notice, is all going to involve the torquing of the body and the hips into it. So even as this leg is pushing me forward, this leg is bending the knee so that my weight kind of drops as I go. If you notice, I'm having some trouble here on the footing, just where I'm standing, because everything is slanted that way. And the snow is getting packed down, becoming slick ice while I'm teaching. And of course there's a variation of the elbow, the outside elbow thrust, which is just simply stepping into sudden thrust. And specifically if you do this in a fight, the best idea is to come in with the idea of using the elbow, but so much as a way of, like I said, you're in the altercation, the guy's here, you strike, stay in your half chamber, strike again, and then instead of coming in with this hand to hit, as you reel him back, step forward, pow, pow, come in a few more elbows, or they're in your face. they push you back, you go into your fighting stance, he goes to the close, and it's pow, pow, and then whip out right there. There's a multitude of different techniques, different things you can do to deal with different situations. Now, on the topic of knee strikes, there's two major types. One is a linear, direct, rising knee. The other is what's referred to as a roundhouse knee. Roundhouse knees are good for attacking the sides of the body. If your opponent is standing, you at a side angle, you're attacking the body. It's the sides. So what you're dealing with a roundhouse knee is you're going to be here. Your leg's going to come out, in, almost like a roundhouse. So you're going to be fighting, do your thing, grab, clinch, and pow. As that knee comes across, the thighs, hips are good, ribs are good. A lot of Muay Thai guys will jump into it, put a lot of their weight into it, Of course, now I'm thinking of what I'm doing looks pretty because I'm in jeans and a jacket. Then, of course, you have the basic knee strike, which is essentially you're here, you're doing your thing, the guy gets in your face, and you grab knee, come down in your fighting stance, and go from there with whatever you need to do. Now, if you notice, I've been going through a progression, a set progression of basic body mechanics. Body mechanics into basic striking into infighting, basic infighting, into grappling, and then I'm going to bring grappling in the ground fighting, or stand-up grappling in the ground fighting. Then I'm going to bring it back from ground fighting to standing to getting the hell out of dodge. And you don't have to follow this natural progression, but it's good to know that, you know, there's different levels to different things and to train yourself so that when you deal with that one guy there, your mind's on.
The basic part of this video is going to deal with some basic grappling techniques, stand up, a few ways of getting your opponent to the ground, and basic ground fighting, primarily positioning. So I'm going to move into that next. Basic lapel grab. Now, there's several ways of getting out of this. One way, of course, is what they teach with a lot of women's self-defense classes, is to come up and break. That's actually not a good idea. The easiest way to do it is to, is to lift your arm up, step over, and then come back with the elbow. Plus, as I'm stepping over here, if he grabs hold of me, as you can tell, now, I'm also going to demonstrate another way of doing it. Go ahead with the lapel grab. Instead of trying to break his arms free, I can simply break his hold. To do this, I use a knife hand strike to the inside of his wrist and a palm heel strike to the back side of his hand. The effect is, as you can tell, it breaks his hand loose. As I'm doing so, I can clasp his hand like this and then just simply... another one I'm going to get into is a basic wrist escape. It's very simple. All it is when someone grabs your wrist, you circle your hand to the outside along their thumb and just push their hand away. It'll break their grip. And just go ahead and grab my wrist. Alright, now as he's grabbed my wrist, all I have to do is bring my hand around the side of his thumb and I'm going to let go. In this case, he had my coat instead of my actual wrist, which works the same way because as he does this, I can still go out. And suddenly, I have his arm. Now, I'm also going to go into a few basic takedowns and throws, which I'll do at a different part. The next thing I want to get into is a few basic chokes. One, which is extremely effective, which is also one of the reasons for the lapel grab, is the cross-collar choke. Basically, you grab a person's collar here, and when you grab it back here, all you do is you straighten your arms out like this. Now, in this case, he's smart and he ducks his chin, so I can't really get that choke hold on.
most people won't think of that. He knew it was coming. Now, in the case of dealing with someone who tucks their chin, you have to go about this a completely different way. Instead of trying to grab their collar and affect the choke, what you do is you have to strike a double knife hand strike coming back into the throat, grab, and then... Now, that right there is effective, except for the fact that he can resist and he can still hit me in the head. Now, there's a variation of this from behind, where you grab the collar, it's all right, where you grab the collar here, and then pull over. Now, as you're pulling the collar over, you're pulling it into the carotid artery. And if you grab the other collar, again, you simply grab them, pull them down, choke them out. The rear naked choke, sleeper roll. Now, as you get into it, all it is you put your arm around their neck, as so their windpipe is here in the crook of your elbow. And you slide the other arm over this one and push back into their head. Now, as you're doing this, this hand is pushing their head down while this arm is tightening the grip, the vise between your bicep and your forearm. Again, you want to use the blade of your forearm into their neck, so this way you simply choke them out. Again, 5 to 15 seconds, depending on how well you do. There we go. He got it dead on me that time, just instant. It's, you know, like I said, basic choke holds. They're really effective for neutralizing your drunk friends. They're good for a very good point of choke hold, which doesn't get mentioned a lot in martial arts, is that when you're fighting multiple opponents, it's easy to grab one in a choke hold and use him as a human shield while the others are trying to get behind you. So it works the same way for the ground. If you can get a guy, if you're on the ground, you can get a guy in a choke hold. Him over top of you and use him as a human shield and let his buddies kick the crap out of him instead of kicking the crap out of you. It helps. We're going to move into a basic inside, outside leg sweep, and a hip throw. Before I get into this, I'm also going to demonstrate a shoulder throw. There's a very important lesson to the shoulder throw. I'm not actually going to fully demonstrate it because of room constraints. And being able to break a person's elbow. There's a technique for snapping their elbow, which is used as part of a shoulder throw. It's also a good counter for a choke. So go ahead and grab him for the choke.
For a choke?
Yeah. Now, as he's grabbing for the choke, what I do is I break his hand. Now, this is going to be a little bit harder to do because he's resisting me, but at some point, I'm going to get his arm out. As I do, I turn the elbow down and pull it. And as you can tell, as I'm pulling his elbow down, he's wanting to take that pressure off the elbow. I'm pulling it against my chest, not my shoulder, but my chest, because if I pull it against my shoulder, I can break my clavicle. So as I'm pulling his elbow down against my chest, his immediate response is to try to lift up. And even if I don't, I can still catch him with the shoulder throw. But as I'm pulling him here, and he's wanting to lift up, all I have to do is drop. And as I'm dropping my weight, he gets top-heavy, falls forward on his face, which is why we're not doing it. And I can break the elbow all in the same move. When a person grabs you from behind like this, there's two ways. In one case, which he's smart enough to do that most people don't, he's burying his chin into my shoulder so that I can't hit him with the back of my head. A lot of people don't really do that. So, but in the case of someone who does do that, in the case of someone who has me from a chokehold normally, or from rear bear hug, normally he would have his head behind me. So all that I have to do is push my arm straight out as if I'm pushing someone away and drop my weight and snap my head back, which I'm not going to do. Well, it's not snap my head back. I'm going to push out like so. And as you notice, it puts me below him and easy to snap my head back and hit him in the chin. Where instead of trying to break the control with the head, that I simply lower my weight as so, and I can tip him over. Or I can reach down between my legs, pick up his ankle, which I'm not going to do because I'd break his leg, and then set on his knee, which will snap his leg. Now, as I was mentioning earlier from the rear bear hug, when he grabs me from behind, I can lower my weight. As I'm lowering my weight, of course, if he can't, since my attacker for this is taller than me, it's kind of hard for him to keep hold of me while I lower my weight.
Yeah.
In the process of, but
for whatever reason he has hold of me. As I'm coming down, all I do is grab this leg. If I can't reach it, grab the pants leg and lift it up. And then as he falls, set. The basic part of this video is going to deal with some basic grappling techniques, stand up, a few ways of getting your opponent to the ground, and basic ground fighting, primarily positioning. So I'm going to move into that next.
Now, I'm going to get into the basic fundamentals of blocking techniques. There are three major blocks taught in street-focused jiu-jitsu. This is an inside block, an outside block, and a low block. Starting from your basic fighting stance, your closed guard, if you will. From here, an outside block is nothing more than bring your arm up and out, push your knee back away from you. The rear view will look like this, simply pushing it away. The inside block is where your arm comes in and pull the attack in further. So it will look like this, or this from the side angle. Now, your low block is used for protecting your legs. It's also used to counter attacks to the groin. And it's nothing more than an exaggeration of an inside block. All you're doing is coming down like this, using your body weight to shift the leg. Basically, all your movements are just as simple as this. It cuts down on a lot of complication. You only have two general motions to remember. This also comes into the idea of keeping your hand up, since as you can block, if a punch comes at you directly, you can block the hand and use your inside hand to punch it down also to grab the wrist or elbow. Is to keep your movement small, so when someone's punching you in the face and you block to the outside, your motion is small, it's not exaggerated, out to here, which leaves this whole area open. It is simply out to here, and it allows you to come back down the counter for a second punch, or to counterattack. So as you're simply blocking here, your hands are in pocket and strike. Basic idea. This way, like I said, you're going to strike. The basic idea is to keep your movement small so you can get in and close the gap. Now, whenever you're closing the gap and you're getting inside, so we're going to move into a different positioning for your hands. This is what's referred to as the CQC, or close quarters combat guard, or your close quarters guard. The idea is that you bring your hands up like this. Now, this is done for two reasons. One, because you'll be getting into a clinch in a fight. Two is that at close range and moving into the clinch, you want to be able to defend yourself from attacks. So that if you're in this position and someone's attacking you to your face, you can, of course, have the inside blocking mechanism. Also, as far as anyone coming to the outside, you have your hands already up. And we'll get into how to use that a little bit later. Said I'm going into the whole blocking techniques. I'm going to demonstrate what I'm talking about here. I'm just using the lead hand to block with. As you can tell, he's attacking. Use one hand to block with. Move in. Yourself. And this is where I'm going with my close guard. Strike, shack, knees, elbows comes in at. It's also where the thumb to the eye stuff comes in at. As I'm closing my guard, and I've got it here, I control his head. As long as I control his head, I decide where he wants to go. So then, when I get into this position, where I'm inside his guard, we're punching, kicking, whatever. I'm in here, and I have control of his head. I decide what he wants to go. Now, my two immediate reactions from this is, am
inside and the outside legs curl. Totally demonstrated. Now, moving into the inside legs curl, all it is go back to our changing pose. As I'm coming in and I grab him, my first reaction to affect the inside legs curl is pulling him in, knee to the groin. As I knee him in the groin, this foot kicks out and back, breaking the neck. All I have to do is just go back with force, and he falls down because his stability is taken care of. The knee to the groin serves to distract him, and this, if I'm gouging at his eyes or hitting him in the head, his immediate reaction is going to be, well, final attack, instead of just that hand because he's a trained fighter. Most of the trained fighters are going back. Even here, he's leaning back to avoid the pack. As he's doing so, he's exposing the groin to my kick or my knee. Now, an outside leg sweep is less combative. It's simply a matter of we're doing our thing, we're fighting, and happen to grab an arm. And for whatever reason, he turns to the side or grabs my wrist or whatever to pull me into it. So as I do, I'm starting to use my hip to break his balance, which is pretty much basically a hip flip. And allows me, as I'm coming in for the hip throw, instead of grabbing him here, rock wall behind us, and that would bust his head wide open, which comes back to the idea of using your environment as a weapon. A more easier way to do so is as we're going whatever, I simply come out instead of trying to overbalance him because he has good balance or whatever. I take my foot, pull up, and catch his leg. And again, as you can tell, rock wall, environment as a weapon. This is one of those things that must be covered in training. You must, while you're training, accept that your environment is a weapon. It is something for you to use. Right now, we're going back to the basic infighting thing. I had mentioned before how to use the hook to affect an arm lock. I'm going to go into that now. So we're throwing, I'm blocking, and as we do, instead of coming in with the block, instead of coming with the outside block, which is fairly common, he throws his punch. I'm going to step in and cut the ear with the hook. As I do, if you notice, his arm is against my head. The reason for this, and I'm going to allow this, the other arm, which is keep up, is here to block. So it's here to intercept and push it out. Variation of the inside block. As I do, I'm going to grab his wrist. What I have to do is I have to keep everything as transient. Everything must be in a constant state of flow. So as I'm coming in, and again, you see, I'm using elbow strikes to counter elbow strikes. Now, as I'm coming in, and I have you know, another variation of this is from a cover. Where I have to grab hold my guy. And I'm over here defending myself, blocking, kneeing, striking, as I'm going. What's going to happen is I'm going to grab his wrist now. I have his wrist, and I'm twisting it up this way. Holding it with both hands, and I'm pushing down on his arm with my elbow. The elbow has to push against his head. My elbow has to, my forearms, push against his elbow. I'm pulling up on his wrist to make this effect. Now, how that's going to work, and there's different ways of going into it. That's what's referred to as an inside wrist lock, cross arm lock. I can also do so by grabbing his wrist and turning out this way to pull it down. You notice he's going to come in to attack me while I'm doing this. So it's not just I'm going to stand here and oh let me do this. It's not going to work that way. This isn't a Steven Seagal move. What's going to happen is we're fighting, he grabs me. So if I'm doing this, I'm going to have to adjust to it. In this case, I'm going to have to be able to move with it. If you notice, my elbow's up here to keep him from being able to get in. And as I'm striking, turning the arm, I have to bend with it. And as you see, it doesn't look completely 100% like you're going to dojo. It's going to look like this. He's going to grab me. I'm going to do this, have his arm, twist it back. He's still going to be able to attack me. So I'm still going to keep my guard up. Now this is really good because the same defense that I'm using, the same way of putting him here and here, I'm going to demonstrate something else. We have environment as a
who has the mount. Basically, in a self-defense situation, I would put him to the ground, gone down on top of him, and while I'm on top of him, I have room to do my punches or go with whatever grappling techniques need to be done. I'm going to break into some really basic stuff here in a moment, primarily dealing with position. This right here is the second best position to be in on a ground fight. Down here, while I'm on top of, there's a lot of things that can be done. What he wants to avoid is letting me get closer to his chest and move up here where I can put all the weight on top of him. To do that, well, in one case, he has a flashlight shining in my eyes, which is kind of a dirty trick that not very many people expect. But to stay there and keep me from doing it, he wants to keep his elbows tucked. So both of his elbows right here are pointing right into my thighs, so I can't really get my knees up on him. Now, I can sit here and I can rain down punches on him, and there's a defense for this, which I'm going to get into. However, my primary goal is to move from this position to what is referred to as the rear mount. Now, in order to do this, I want his hands in front of his face while I'm punching him and he's blocking. As he's doing this, my immediate response will be to grab one of his wrists, doesn't matter which one. I'm going to push his elbow to the side and put all my weight on this wrist. And once I do so, he really can't get up because he's, or can't move his arm. You can try and move it whenever you want, for whatever reason. Now, you have to be careful because at this point, he can hit me in the groin or whatever else. The groin is a very open target from the mouth. Now, as I'm doing this, I come down, reach around behind his head with my free hand. And what I'm doing, now if you notice, he's pulling onto my arm. That's fine. I'm not worried about it. I can push down the face, punch him, whatever. My goal is to pull this arm right here and to get him to move. Now, he's resisting me, and he's got a hold of my t-shirt to keep me from doing it, which is a good thing for counter defense. Now, if I'm punching him, it's going to be a little bit of a different story. If I'm hitting him in the ribs, the face, whatever, he's going to be kind of moving. Just go ahead and roll over. Now, as I'm rolling him over from behind, even if I have him here, which is basically halfway between the side mount, let's say he starts trying to break my fingers or something, I have to let go. I put in a position to where he's on his side, he's still going to defend himself. Now, me hitting him in the back of the skull is not going to do much damage. So what my goal is to keep him so that he rolls over into this position. Once he's here, I can do a palm heel strike to the base of the skull, driving it forward into the ground. I can also sink my legs in to where he can't really buck me off while I'm hitting him here, the temples. And of course, from this position, I'm behind him, my weight's on top of him, so I can choke him out. That right there is a transition from the top mount to the rear mount. The problem is, your next stage, is when you get taken to the ground, you have to go from being in on the receiving end of the mount to in the guard to the back mount. Transitioning is important because as long as you can gain a dominant position, whatever grappling techniques you use, choke holds, etc., will have more effect. However, you have to be careful at grappling at close range because that still leaves attacks to the eyes, throat, groin, and so forth very easy, very open targets. Now, in this case, I want to demonstrate getting out of the mount. Like I said, first off, I want to keep my elbows up so that he can't really get in. Now, as I'm here, I'm left with two options because he's going to try to move closer onto my chest and I'm going to need to get out of it or get one of my arms trapped. I'm going to have to do what's referred to as a shrimp. Shrimping is just a matter of rolling my hips and pushing off on his leg. Since he's pushing his forearm into the side of my neck, in order to get out of this and keep his weight off of me, what I'm going to have to do is move the leg to the side, push his leg. And as you notice, as I'm pushing his leg, I'm pretty much breaking him off the ground. If I can get him to roll from the ground, I'm good. Here, go back to the top mount again. Now, again, as he's on top of me, there's another option. That option being that while he has me in this right here, I can bring my arm across to trap his. Now, while this allows me to go for wrist locks, whatnot,
it also puts me in a position to where, for example, let's say he's punching me. Oh, okay, elbow works just fine too. But go for the punch. Unless he's going for the punch, I move to the side. It's like I said, simple variation of the hook. As I'm coming up to attack, which he's not really paying attention to, this other arm is coming across, and I'm trapping him. I'm bringing him down to my level to where I can get him into his elbows and bring him into a choke, which he's trying to break.
With that cat.
And even more so, as we're going back to this, all I have to do is while he's trying to transition to get back to his position, roll my hips, use that to get my momentum to come in. As he's trying to block, I still have his groin open. This right here would be the position he would be in defending on the ground.
If you can't reach right
here. And what sucks about this is because I'm short, and this will probably happen in a lot of fights. He'll grab me by the throat, be hitting me in the face, whatever. So I got to try and defend. Now, from the guard, there's a lot of ways of getting around it. The idea of trying to transition from the guard to something else just doesn't really apply to me. I don't think it works. Your best bet is to go for a cross arm bar. What that means is, while he's got me here, I bring this arm up, and I try to get my legs up around him, his neck. Then I simply lock over, secure the wrist, whoa, and torque back. Now we have him in a cross arm bar. The beautiful thing about this is I don't have to try and be the next Hoist Gracie and make him tap. While I have his arm, I can kick him in the face with this foot, which I'm not going to do, or I can go for a wrist lock, lean forward, and trap, and just lock hold of the arm, torque and turn however I want. In this case, I would actually have dislocated his shoulder to get in the dominant position, either on top of your opponent or out from under him. Out from under him is the thing you really got to worry about. Next, we come into the guard. The guard is a good position to be in if you're going to be on the bottom. It's about the third best position to be in. Basic ground fighting does not exist so that you can go into a fight thinking you're going to be the next UFC champion. You are not going to walk in and think you're going to take the fight to the ground. We're talking about self-defense. Self-defense is what's referred to as METT. METT basically refers to it's a military acronym. Quite simply put, it's basically your environment. Movement, time, terrain, equipment. For example, we had a good example of that with him shining the flashlight in my eyes. All right, we're talking about METT. Well, movement. We were on the ground, so movement was pretty much going to be slow as far as being able to break contact. Equipment, he shined a flashlight in my eyes. Contemporarily blind before I know it, I get stabbed in the groin or the stomach. I'm screwed because you have to always assume your attacker has a weapon. It's better to assume the worst and find out it's not as bad as you think as it is to walk about life and say, oh, everything's going to be fine, and then somebody beats the crap out of you and takes your wallet.
And believe it.
Now, beyond that, you go into the next little phase of it, of saying going to the ground is not a good idea. Do not go to the ground. However, since you're not going to the ground, or since you're trying to stay away from the ground, you should also remember that getting away from the ground shouldn't be your sole objective. You shouldn't be afraid to take the fight to the ground. It's better to take the fight to the ground than to be taken to the ground. I want you to understand that looking at the first set, that was simply the beginner phase, the raw basics. A lot of the techniques demonstrated can be used outside of the way they were demonstrated. For example, the cross collar choke from the front. Instead of simply holding the cross collar choke and being beat to death by your opponent, you can use it while executing headbutts. You can use the stand up from a mount. The cross arm bar, which was taught from the guard, can likewise be used from the mount, which is the purpose for getting your knees as close to the chest, but one of the purposes for getting your knees as close to the chest as possible. This allows you to simply fall to the side, kick them in the face, and torque the arm while suspending your upper body to break that arm. The technique for
executing a stand-up cross armbar can likewise be executed by stepping back and pulling the arm and stepping over to torque up on the elbow the same way you did with the knee on one of the escape for the rear bear hug techniques. You can combine the rear headbutt method of escape with the breaking the leg method of escape. Nothing is written in stone. You should not simply say, okay, well, it was demonstrated as this, and that's it. That right there is the raw basics. They're intended to teach you the basic techniques and the basic principles behind the techniques so that you have a foundation. Now, this is what's referred to as fundamental awareness. You have to train the basics harder than anything else. You have to get your foundation. A house built on a weak foundation will not last. And what we're doing here is we're building your castle. And once you're inside your castle, you can't be harmed. Right now, we've covered the basics of how to defend your castle, how to strike out from your castle. But you don't simply want to look at it and say, okay, well, this tower is here only for this, or this wall is here only for this. Everything has its uses. Everything has variant uses. For every rule, there's an exception to the rule. This is why sparring is important. And when I say sparring, I'm not talking about simply partial resistance, tap, tap, slap, back and forth sparring. I am talking about full contact, full speed, actually beating the crap out of each other sparring. Now, technique should be started off on a padded surface with no resistance. And then move from no resistance to partial resistance to eventually being able to employ all of them at full speed, full resistance on that padded surface. Then you move from that padded surface to, say, hard dirt or grass, and then hard dirt, and then hardwood floors, and then concrete, and then asphalt. And you get used to fighting on different surfaces so that the surface itself is your enemy. And you do so because you want to learn to use your environment. You also want to build up resistance to the shock of having a different sort of stimuli used against you. When I'm talking about stimuli, here's a basic way of explaining it. Your body will get used to any sensation it feels over time. It repeatedly feels over time. What this means is that people who want to be resistant to pain have to experience pain to a point their mind, their conscious mind, their subconscious mind says, okay, this is something I've felt before, this is something I've dealt with before, I don't like it, but I can cope. And it's not a shock to you. To give you an idea, I have a friend of mine from Puerto Rico. He's never been in weather below 50 degrees. He came to visit me in West Virginia. It snowed. It dropped to 38 degrees. And this guy went in, literally, his body went into shock because he had never experienced it before. He had never experienced that level of cold before. His body wasn't going into hypothermia. It was too warm for him to actually experience hypothermia. His body wasn't freezing. He had only been exposed to it for a matter of minutes, and yet he was sitting there shaking uncontrollably because his body had never been that cold before, being used to Puerto Rico with 50 degrees being the coldest in winter. Now, afterwards, he sent me an email telling me that, you know, after spending a couple weeks up here with me and getting used to the cold, when he went back to Puerto Rico, he was running around in shorts and a tank top where everybody else was bundled up because he had been used to something colder than what he was dealing with there. So the idea is, in training, you're going to experience things. You're going to condition yourself to experience things. They're going to be a little bit tougher, a little bit harder than what you're going to run into in most cases on the street. You know, getting into a fight in a parking lot with some drunk guy is going to be very different from taking on multiple opponents or from taking on a single skilled opponent who is in conscious control of himself, especially someone who is not fighting for, well, it's kind of hard to explain. A skilled opponent is a good thing, but a lot of times in a street fight, it comes down to stupid luck. And here's the problem with stupid luck. I can take you down with a single leg takedown. You can be a better fighter than me. You can just relax and go to the ground for the simple fact that you want to take me into the guard and choke me out on the ground while I'm trying to pull you down with the single leg takedown. At the same time, you can bust your head open on the curb and go into a coma and die simply because of dumb, stupid luck. So what we're going to condition you to do is not only fight your environment, which is an enemy, but fight your opponent, which is an enemy. And at the same time, maintain your awareness for everything around you, just in case there's simply more than those two enemies. No matter what, your goal should always be fundamental awareness, having your basics down pat, working your basics, working your footwork, working your break falls, working on applying techniques from different positions and not simply saying, okay, I'm here, I've learned this technique the way it's taught this way, and leave it at that. That's kind of what Bruce Lee was talking about when he was talking about styles and fixed positions and dead stylings and dead traditions, is that they do something in a fixed way, taught on a fixed form.